الله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله عز وجل، وخير الهدي هدي نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة. All praise is due to Allah, we praise Him, we seek His aid and we ask for His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evils of ourselves and the evil consequences of our own actions. Whomsoever Allah guides, none can lead astray, and whomsoever Allah leaves to go astray, none can guide. I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped, none has the right to our ultimate love and devotion except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, who has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is his servant and his messenger. All you who believe, fear Allah as He should be feared, and die not except in a state of submission and Islam to Allah. O mankind, be dutiful to your Lord who created you from a single person, and from him He created his wife, and from them both He created many men and women. And fear Allah through whom you demand your mutual rights, and observe the rights of your kinship. Surely Allah is ever and all watcher over you. O you who believe, keep your duty to Allah. Fear Him and speak the truth. He will direct you to righteous deeds and will forgive you your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has indeed attained a great achievement. Indeed, the best of speech are the words of Allah, and the best guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst thing in the religion are the newly invented matters. And all the newly invented matters in religion are innovation and bid'ah. Every bid'ah is misguidance and it leads to the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives an advice, a powerful advice in the Quran, when He says, and He addresses it to the believers directly, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَّا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدٍ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ. O you who believe, have taqwa, have fear of Allah, be dutiful to Allah, be mindful and aware of Allah. وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَّا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدٍ. Let each self or each soul look carefully at what it has prepared for tomorrow. What it has prepared for tomorrow. And then Allah says again, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ. And fear Allah, be mindful of Him and be dutiful to Him. This is an advice that should be on our minds day and night, in all our affairs. Because in these short words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us a profound advice where He reminds us of the reality of this existence. That all what matters to you, all what you should focus upon is to prepare for tomorrow. Because if you are preparing for 5 years from now, 10 years from now, because we have short-term plans, we have long-term plans, we have 10 years plans, we have 20-year kind of vision, we have 40-year, we want to see what we want to do when we retire, where we want to live, what kind of lifestyle we want. We keep planning for the future. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we say, I'm preparing myself for tomorrow. I'm getting ready for tomorrow. But in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying the real tomorrow is not in this world. Because tomorrow that you are planning for and you are getting ready for, it might never come. It might never be a reality. You might leave this world before that tomorrow become a reality. But the only tomorrow that is sure to happen, that there is no doubt about it, is that you will be resurrected on the day of judgment. You will be brought back to life. And you will have the you'll have to deal with the consequences of your choices in this world and in this life. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدْ. Let a soul look carefully at it, what it has prepared or has, what it has put forth for tomorrow. Are you ready for tomorrow? Have you prepared yourself for tomorrow? Because tomorrow might be today for you. Because the moment your soul leaves this world, your tomorrow has started. And the Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ مَاتَ فَقَدْ قَامَتْ قِيَامَتُهُ. The one who dies, his day of judgment has started. The last day has started for that person. So your tomorrow could be closer than the tomorrow that we look forward to. And that moment of death could come at any time. And this is why you should be ready for death to come and snatch you. You should be prepared for that. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the verse that we quote in every Jum'ah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. And do not die except in a state of Islam. Do not die except as Muslims. Except in a state of submission to Allah. That means be prepared all the time. Be in a state of submission and belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when death comes to you, you are ready. Not like the ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about when He says, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتُ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ. So when death comes to one of them, they says, oh Allah, send me back. Send me back. ارْجِعُونَ, send me back. لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِيمَا تَرَكْتْ. So hopefully I would be able to do some righteousness, some good deeds, something good before death comes to me. Send me back. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kalla. No, indeed, there is no return. There is no return. This is a one-way ticket. Once you leave this world, there's no return. You can't come back here. You can't make amends. You can't fix your actions. There is no way to come back. But you have been given ample time, enough opportunities to realize what this life is all about, to live your life true to Allah and dutiful to your Lord, and make good use of the time that you have here. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not take a soul until that soul has taken enough warnings and enough evidence about the truth of this life. So the point here in this life is to be prepared for that tomorrow, because that's the real future. When you think about your future, the real future is on the day of judgment. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ. That the akhirah, the next life, that's the real life. That's the real life. What we are going through is merely a dream. It's merely a mirage. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the people who have lost themselves, and on the day of judgment they wake up to the reality, and these people would say, وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةُ يُقْسِمُ الْمُجْرِمُونَ مَا لَبِثُوا غَيْرَ سَاعَةً. And when the sa'ah, when the hour arises, when the day of judgment starts, those who have done wrong, they will look around and sort of, they've just woken up to the reality, to the truth. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَبَصَرُكَ الْيَوْمَ حَدِيدٌ. On the day of judgment, we will see facts for what they are. The delusion will be taken away. The screen will be lifted. The lies, the misconceptions would disappear. And we would see everything for what it really is. That's why Allah says, فَبَصَرُكَ الْيَوْمَ حَدِيدٌ. Today, your eyesight, your inside is so clear and accurate. There is no delusion. There's no misconceptions today. So when these people wake up to the reality on the Day of Judgment, they swear, we lived only for 1 hour. The whole life was just 1 hour. 70, 80 years, it just feels like 1 hour. Because in reality, that's what it really is. But we live under the delusion of time. And what is 100 years? What is 1,000 years compared to eternity? What is it? So that's the real tomorrow and that's the real life. You worry about your savings. You worry about your children's future, about their education. You worry about paying off the house that you bought. You think about the next house you're going to buy. You think about the next business, the next moving business. There's nothing wrong with this. But don't limit your vision to that kind of future. There is a more important, more eminent type of future that you need to be ready for. Because that's your real life. And that's your real future. And that's the best investment. It's with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how do we get ready for tomorrow? How do we get ready to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment and reap the fruits of being obedient and truthful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The first thing you need to start with is repent to Allah. Return to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Say, O my servants who have transgressed against themselves, who have gone too far with their sins, with their crimes, with their evil, never lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Never fall in despair of the mercy of Allah. لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا. Indeed, Allah forgives all sins. Allah forgives all sins. Why? Because He's Al-Ghafoor Al-Rahim. His name is that He's the merciful, He's the oft-forgiving. He's the one who forgives sins. But when does He forgive? When you repent. When does He forgive? When He sees goodness in your heart. When He sees sincerity. When He sees goodwill. But carrying on, being carried away with wretchedness, with evil, and with bad deeds, and then saying, Allah will forgive me. This might be a very dangerous path to take. Very dangerous path. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks into your heart and He sees what goodness there is in your heart. And based on this, He treats you. And the ones who fear the punishment of Allah are the ones who are the most likely to get the mercy of Allah. And these are the ones that are most likely to repent to Allah and go back to Him. And the reality of repentance, the reality of at-tawbah, is that you return to Allah in your heart before your body and soul return to Him. That's what tawbah is. At-tawbah an ta'uda lillahi azza wa jal. An ta'uba ila Allahi biqalbik qabla an ta'uda ilayhi biruhika wa badanik. That's at-tawbah. You return, you make a choice, a conscious choice, that I want to return to Allah while I am alive. I want to make my journey now to Allah before my body makes its journey back to Allah when death comes. So I want to be with Allah before my body leaves, before my soul leaves my body. That's where I want to be with Allah. I want to make the journey from now. And this is how you get prepared for that real tomorrow and for your real future. So it's about repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most perfect of human beings, the most righteous, the most knowledgeable of Allah, the most fearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, استغفر الله واتوب إليه. He says, seek forgiveness of Allah and repent to Him. He says, فَإِنِّي لَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ فِي الْيَوْمِ سَبْعِينَ مَرَّةً. That I, and the Prophet is talking about himself, I seek Allah's forgiveness and I repent to Him each day 70 times at least. And that's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what can we do? All you can do is when you wake up in the morning, when you open your eyes, make a conscious intention. Oh Allah, I want to repent to You today. I want to come back to You. I feel the pain and the sorrow and the regret in my heart for the wrong choices that I made. I recognize my weakness. I know it and I feel it and I'm struggling with it. Sometimes it takes the better of me and it pushes me into sin. I recognize this weakness. I'm not happy with it. I want to change it. Help me change it. I repent to You. Please grant me forgiveness and accept my tawbah. If you do this every day in the morning or in the evening, make it a point. Take a note of it. Take a note of it. It's as simple as that. And repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter how much you sin, at least make it a point to come back to Allah. At some time in the day, turn to Allah, say to Allah, I regret it. I feel bad for that. I feel the pain in my heart for transgressing your limits and going against your commands. Please forgive me. Please help me give up on my sins. Please help me become a better person. As simple as that. That's what tawbah is. So you feel the regret, you feel the remorse, and you have a strong intention not to go back into that sin. Yes, tomorrow you might fall again to the sin. Yourself, your desire might take over and push you into the sin. But you never give up. You never give up. Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, people who do, or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that the son of Adam makes a sin. Then he seeks Allah's forgiveness. He repents to Allah. Allah accepts his forgiveness, his repentance, and Allah forgives him. Then he falls again into the sin. Then he turns to Allah seeking forgiveness. Allah forgives him. Then he falls again into the sin. Then he turns to Allah and asks for forgiveness. Allah grants him forgiveness. Abu Dharr questioned that. He said, أَيَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to forgive him? Like falling into the sin over and over and over and over again? The same sin? The Prophet ﷺ says, يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَهُ رَغْمَ أَنْفِي أَبِيذَرْ. Allah will forgive him, even though you don't agree to that, Abu Dharr, or you can't seem to understand it. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Lord and my Lord. Because Allah loves forgiveness. But your heart has to be in the right state and your tongue has to pronounce it. Turn to Allah. Show your weakness. Show your need to Him. Because if you think you can repent to Allah or you can give up a sin because of your own excellence, because of your own intelligence, because of your own righteousness, you're fooling yourself. The reason you can repent is because Allah guides you to this repentance. Allah instructs you to repent. Allah inspires you to repent. And Allah guides you to repent. And Allah puts the words on your mouth. Allah puts the feelings in your heart. And Allah makes you do it. And then Allah accepts it. And this is how Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah explains the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ تَابَ عَلَيْهِمْ لِيَتُوبُ. Then Allah accepted their repentance so that they can repent to Him. So the acceptance comes before you repent. And that's why you are guided to it. That's our Lord. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That sometimes we teach our children about Allah's going to take you out. Allah's going to put you in the fire. You don't listen to me, Allah will punish you in the hellfire. And that's a lie. That's a lie. When you tell a child, if you lie, Allah will punish you. That's a lie. Because Allah doesn't punish children. Children are unaccountable. But we're giving them the wrong impressions about Allah. And we keep feeding that into their brains until they grow up with an image or an understanding about Allah that Allah is an angry kind of being who wants just to take them out and who's lying in wait for any mistake. And then we try to teach them aqidah and we realize deep down there is so much that needs to be changed. And it's hard even to get to that. Why? Because we're unconscious of what we say. So that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He Himself accepts your repentance before you repent. And this is why He guides you to repentance. So repentance is not your own merit. It's not your own excellence. It's not your own righteousness. It's not even your decision. It's Allah's gift to you. But you need to wake up and return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in order to prepare for tomorrow, that's the main thing, is to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a daily basis and seek forgiveness and feel the pain and the sorrow and the regret for going against the instructions and commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم من كل ذنب. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. Another thing that we can do, another important thing that we can do in order to prepare for tomorrow is just to make a good deed every day, consciously. Consciously. Same thing when you wake up in the morning. Say, today I want to do something special for the sake of Allah. Yes, you pray the 5 daily prayers. You observe your obligations. But do something special each day for Allah. Something special. Something maybe you haven't done before. Or you haven't done in a long time. Do consciously choose to do it. Because this increases your sense of purpose. Your sense of consciousness. And that's an important element of taqwa. You are being conscious and aware of Allah. Being mindful of Allah. Doing things with purpose. Not out of habit. Not as a routine. But being conscious, getting out of your way to do something you are not used to doing. And do it for the sake of Allah. Allah appreciates this so much. Allah appreciates this so much. And it makes you conscious. Because a lot of us are going through life like robots. We caught up in a routine, in a system, in a rigid system. And we go through life unconscious, most of the time unconscious. We drive. We don't even realize the roads we took. We just became so desensitized. We're on autopilot most of the time. We go do the work that we do, we most of the time unconscious. We go back home mainly unconscious. We try to medicate ourselves with food, with drinks, with TV, with internet and YouTube and Facebook and casual conversations. All of it is robotic. We're even missing out on life. We're not living consciously. We're not aware that we are going through time. We're not aware that we are alive. So this is when death comes. We realize we haven't been even living. We've been asleep. We've been asleep for most of our life. So live your life more consciously. More consciously. Do things on purpose. Things you are not used to doing for the sake of Allah. Good deeds. Make them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the sake of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a very powerful thing to do. And this will connect you to Allah. It's not only the deed that you do, but when you get used to the system that every day I'm going to think of something. It's not ready. It's not already made. I'm going to think of something and come up with an idea to do something for Allah. Just this sense of initiative and purpose and mindfulness is so powerful and transformative. It's going to leave a big impact on your heart and on your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine you have like a husband and a wife. Life becomes dull after some time. They get used to each other, the same kind of things over and over again. The love starts to dissipate and disappear from their life. They feel a bit bored. Then problems start to take place in the house. But if one of them makes a conscious effort to do something different, something they've never done before. So the husband goes and buys a special gift he's never bought for his wife before. Or she gets him something he loves, but she never did that before. Sometimes it could be just a simple touch. It could be just a beautiful word. It could be just going out for food or going on a picnic or anything simple. As long as it is well thought of and intentional and purposeful, it makes a big difference. It shifts the whole vibe of the relationship. So imagine you do this with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the consciousness. It's your spirit. It's that you care about Allah. It's that you are connected to Allah. And you're mindful of Allah. And Allah means a lot to you. So, and Allah doesn't need our actions, but all of these are going to feed back into us, into our hearts, and into our souls. So, with these two things, simple things that the Prophet ﷺ has instructed us about, do righteous deeds and repent to Allah. You're going to see everything in life will start changing. As simple as that. Simple things. Islam is not complicated. It's not difficult. It's simple. It's so human. It's so down to earth and easy to implement, but profound in its impact on the heart and the soul. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us these things. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم كن المستضعفين من المؤمنين في كل مكان، اللهم احقن دماءهم، اللهم صن أعراضهم، اللهم احفظ عليهم دينهم وإيمانهم، اللهم كن للمسلمين في كل مكان، اللهم كن للمسلمين في كل مكان، اللهم من كان منهم في جفاف وفي معاناة، اللهم فأنزل عليهم رحماتك وبركاتك من السماء، اللهم من كان منهم مظلوما فارفع عنهم الظلم، اللهم من كان منهم أسيرا ففك أسرهم، اللهم من كان منهم مريضا فشافهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.